Hello and welcome to day 11 of December Evangelion. I am Tom.
I am Joe.
It's 3.33 time.
Yes.
This is not going to be fun for either of us.
No, absolutely nope. Not.
the depressive and the order.
I don't like this movie, but I don't like it for different reasons than, like, the public kind of rejected it when it came out.
I don't like this film because, yeah, it's... yeah, so, where do we leave off? We left off with 2.22, everything seemed okay, Shinji was gonna rescue Rei, Shinji had started accidentally Third Impact... And,
about that.
Everything went wrong.
In like, all aspects.
In all aspects. Not just, like, the aspects within the film, the aspects without the film as well. This is certainly the most, considering, like, obviously, like, Hideaki Anno has had, like, things related to Evangelion have had troubled production before. This was a complete car crash. I think it's fair to say.
Absolutely, because the movie they previewed for at the end of 2.22 is absolutely not the movie we got.
So there are theories about this. Obviously, to an extent, the next time on Evangelion things tend to be like it's a bit like a cinematic hype, man. It goes, this is what to expect, this is what you're gonna get, this is like a taster.
And especially with the movies, it's kind of, I don't want to say a bait and switch, but it's a placeholder.
Yeah.
Like, especially at the end of 3.33, like, what they suggest just absolutely does not happen because they had no idea what was next.
Nope. Yeah. The 1.11 for 2.22, I think, is mostly accurate because by the point they were doing, they'd, like, finished off 2.1.11, they were starting production on 2.22, but that was like, you know, this is like the one time that's been accurate, you know. So just a very, very quickly preview, so the 2.2 thing basically goes, you know, Shinji and Rei are within unit 1, Tokyo 3 and the Geo Front have been abandoned, Nerve are being held in containment, Kaworu is ending up in Terminal Dogma. Assembling of the children. There's a lot of like very Hideaki Anno-ing going on in this, and so there is a speculation that essentially what happens in this trailer with a couple of notable shots, that the Unit 8 shot is like the thing that doesn't happen. Everything else is like implied to have happened in the gap between 2.22 and 3.33, because there's a time jump now.
yes,
this is like so, and we sort of also we need to talk about Hideaki Anno. The depression came back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and not pleasantly. Like you can sort of psych. You can see in, like, 3.33 where Anno is doing, you know, typical Hideaki Anno film things for, like, the first 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and then he goes off a cliff.
Yeah. This is, I think, the longest action series of action sequences that starts, because there are 25 minutes of action
before
it starts to settle into the plot.
Yeah.
And which is pretty neat, but it is... frenetic. Delaying talking about it, like even when Shinji is brought in confused and nobody's answering questions, it is like going action sequence because it does not want doesn't want to do this.
It is like Anno doing basically displacement activity. It's like, oh, but I gotta do an action scene. Oh, we gotta do this, we gotta do this, we gotta do this. You know, there's an almost manic quality to it. It's like, you know, if I do make this an action sequence, I don't have to talk. You know, I don't have to go, oh god, I gotta deal with this over here. The other kind of main, so obviously Anno is like suffering from depression. We'll get into like the gap, because obviously I think he's like trying to work through it and it went badly, and yeah, Hideaki Anno did not do well after this film, and the gap between this and Thrice is it's nearly a decade.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like Hideaki Anno does not do well with the aftermath of 3.33. The other kind of problem with 3.33 is it wasn't just like a delay of production in terms of, you know, the Japanese production. The dub went a bit weird.
Yeah, and this is where we get a lot of theories and a lot of
conjecture.
What we are saying is by no means the truth.
Yeah, so there is
point of this.
No, so there was a leak, I believe, earlier this year of, I think somebody leaked a work print. God, it was basically a in progress cut of 3.33 with the original dub. So obviously, the problem with the original dub is it ends up with like Brian Police. So obviously, you know, so there's obviously like Karu. So Jerry Jewell was going to reprise Karu from the original series. Brina Policia was going to reprise Ray. Clean Clinker Beard. You know, there's like the main five, and then everybody else gets recast. It's nuts. It's like they basically, so they did this dub at, you know, they released this dub in, I think it was an American con, and it went really badly, apparently. So the conjecture goes, it's basically so the rumor goes, they had somebody from Studio Kara actually, like, obviously, because, you know, hey, it's the theatrical premiere of this film, you're gonna have somebody from Studio Kara, and the reaction from the crowd was icy. Really icy.
And this is where you get into the conjecture, because you either get that it was icy, or like there was the audience playing off of Shinji and Kaworu, and they were laughing, or they were like, you know, making a big to-do about the relationship,
Which is central to this film, which is like Kara went, this is going back to the re-script. They didn't even go back to, we're re-recording this, we are re-scripting this. And it's from this point on that Kara really have had a hand on the leash of redubbing, of dubbing. Mm-hmm. So they were obviously very hands-on with the dub of, obviously, the Amazon, Netflix dub, and the Amazon Prime dub. They were also very hands-on with it. I think they obviously were taken a little bit by surprise as to how badly this had been dubbed.
Or just how the response to it, because Japan and America have very different responses to certain things. Like, you will see this all the time, like favorite characters, favorite scenes, and how people respond in the community, and the community responses, certain different things. And I don't think they knew this, like, American Fujoshi response of, like...
Which surprises me, because since 3.33, Kara have really traded in on the figures, merchandise, etc., of Karu and Shinji exchanging loving glances. Like, you can buy Karu and Shinji matching with wedding rings. Official wedding rings. So I think they've warmed to it. If it hasn't been something that obviously they were on board with from the beginning, it's something they've definitely warmed into. Going, yes, we can sell these these Fujoshi some merchandise, I see, right. Okay.
And just let me go a little bit, because yeah. I need to finish the thought here. But, like we said, this is all conjecture, but in the Netflix dub, they took away, like, certain terms. Like, they took away Kaoru's love. It is my grace instead. Yeah. And so there's that to feed this. But on your end, there is the Amazon Prime dub, which I got a month Prime just because I needed to watch a Steelers game for free. Yeah. So anyway, so I watched 3.33 on Prime just to be curious. And it's more alongside, like, pushing the relationship of Kaoru and Shinji. Like, if 3.33, the Blu-ray release, is like, it's a very solemn movie. It kind of, if you listen to the dub, it feels like they are kind of trying to push away from this. So all that's left is, you know, the depression. And this one, they really, the Amazon Prime one with Spike Spencer and a lot of the original cast back and all of that. It really feels like they are pushing on the emotions that Shinji and Kaoru have for each other in this. So, maybe that's just me. I haven't watched, like, I am going to be honest. This is the last time I am ever watching Evangelion 3.33, unless somebody pays me a decent amount of money. I have watched the dub, I have watched the sub, and I have watched the Amazon Prime dub, and each of them once. And you just get the feeling, and maybe I am misremembering the original dub, but it felt like there it was seriously more solemn, and it was more, you know, getting the mood and atmosphere of the general world instead of...
Oh, completely. You know, no, I would agree. I would agree with you there. And, you know, obviously, you've got to consider that is 5 years apart and, you know, the Kaoru Shinji. Kaoru Shinji is a fascinating ship. It's going to be, it's going to be honest. I feel it's, as I said, it feels like, you know, something that really, as I said, if Kara weren't aware of it previously, which surprises me given, like, Kaoru seems to have replaced poor Toji in like 90% of publicity stuff. Like, you go for modern Evangelion publicity stuff and yeah, Toji is nowhere to be seen. Poor Toji.
Yeah,
he didn't deserve. Well, he doesn't get crunched this time, but he does just get booted off the Ava team.
Yes. In fact, that in one moment Shinji has to wear some clothes and he said, "Oh, these are big," and then he looks and it says Toji on it.
Oh, yeah. It's like, hey, remember Toji? Yeah. Well, we might talk about him less next episode. Anyway, so, yeah, the production of this was rocky and a shitstorm and, yeah, sort of like, you know, I can remember, obviously, being, like, an Evangelion fan, like, and coming back to it in the mid-2010s and going, yeah, we're still waiting for the 3.33 DVD. The gap between this getting released and the dub was like 4 years, and you know that is not typical for something the size of Evangelion. And I think it's at this point that sort of like I feel Kara started to go, yeah, we need to have a handle on this. We cannot just let these Americans run around and dub this because anyway,
well, I don't know how much Anno would have had, but if he was severely rocky after this movie for a while,
completely,
and like somebody told Anno, then I don't know if Anno, I like that is again conjecture, but if he was not in a good place, he might have had a hand in that.
Yeah,
if,
I mean, at this point now, Kara have an in-house translator, so it's like that's the size that Evangelion is sort of like at the moment. Oh god, we gotta fucking talk about this thing.
So it starts and they're in space and Mari is singing as she does in two, in two, three, and thrice.
Yep. Mari just fucking sings like musical.
She sings in the action sequences, and they have to get this thing before it falls into orbit.
Mm-hmm. This thing and being a giant sort of floating 2001 monolith-style cross, which might contain our protagonist. It contains our protagonist.
Yeah. But first, it contains an angel.
Oh, yeah. I fucking love this action sequence. I'm gonna be fair, like, there are a few, as we'll come on to very quickly, this is gonna be, I think, for, like, obvious reasons, because it's quite triggering for both of us. This is going to be a short episode, and I'm not gonna like a lot of things in this episode, and, the fight scenes are, I don't think Evangelion ever stiffs on the fight scenes. Like, the fights in this are fine, they're great, there's a great sense of, like, momentum in this space battle, and it has Asuka, so I'm happy for, like, 5 minutes. There is, like, a sense, like, immediately a sense of, like, the game has changed with this, though, because it's, like, where we had, like, one big angel, there's now these sort of, like, really strange sort of like abstract things that are like there's various like weird Evangelion drone sort of things that like, you know, angel, these strange biomechanical mixtures of angels and like other stuff which tend to turn up like as
and
our
Ava's.
Main foes, yeah, as our main foes going. But like the Ava production has just gone into overdrive. I think it's like implied it's nerve, because obviously, yeah, that's the first thing. Like Asuka gets rescued by Mari, and Shinji gets rescued by Asuka and Mari,
yes. Like, it is very clear that something is wrong, because obviously in orbit, the entire Earth, it has red seas instead of blue. Yep. And, obviously we are not going back to Nerve HQ.
Nope.
No.
Not in Kansas anymore, although... Yeah.
Nope. And then once Shinji is escorted and tested, nobody is talking to him, nobody is answering his questions. Mm-hmm. And
people aren't even sure if it is Shinji. I mean, this is like the thing, there's this like the first shot we see of Shinji is like Shinji unconscious and on his foot, it's like Shinji Ikari-esque question mark. It's like we're not even sure if like what we've got back out of this thing is Shinji. And it's like there's a real sense of like, and that I feel sets the tone for the rest of the film.
And then there's just more hints like there's like an angel or something attacking them, and then Shinji's asking, well I can pilot an Ava and fight it, and then Misato's there with sunglasses now and her hair up, and she essentially says, you don't do anything anymore.
Yeah.
Don't do anything.
Yeah. I this is like the other thing I really like. I really like the character dynamic between Mari, Asuka, and Misato, because it's like, you get the sense, particularly between Asuka and Misato, because essentially Misato sort of ended up in the Gendo sort of role, although Gendo is still around, as we'll get onto briefly, but she's become like the distant commanding figure who has to make the tough decisions and is like keeping her cards head to her chest. And Asuka has sort of become, as we'll get onto, because there's been a time jump, and Asuka and Mari and obviously, you know, Misato are, you know, have been basically fighting the fight for 14 years. And Asuka's sort of taken on this almost quasi sort of Misato-ish role. I mean, you see it more, I would say, in Thrice, but it's like she's matured, and it's like there's something like fundamentally broken inside Asuka now, I think.
Yeah, and she's not a boozer, so what? How she deals with it is anger.
Incredible violence.
Lots of anger. And the distancing with Misato also and matching with Gendo also happens because she's a parental figure. So what is essential now is essentially both Shinji's parents that he remembers are turning their backs on him.
Yeah. Yeah, it's and this is where like let's put this up out front. This is not a happy film. It is not a film that likes it being that likes its existence. I think is the simplest way of putting it. It is not a film from a particularly happy mental place. It is a film that doesn't really like being a film. For lack of a better word, I feel.
I don't know. It is just... It feels like... Even more than End of Evangelion, it's a, you made me do this. Why are you making me do this?
I
think the why are you making me do this is a question specifically for 3.33. I mean, End of Evangelion is a you made me do this in a... mischievous kind of way.
Oh, yeah, look what you made me do. Oh, I've killed Asuka. This is like, this is, yeah. I mean, as I said, we don't, because we don't have an insight to Anno's mental. So the biggest source of this was not particularly a good time for Hideki, and it comes from Miyoko. Miyoko did a very short film, I think, obviously, for Studio, I think it was Studio Car, something like Studio Car's 10th anniversary.
And it's to put a point of reference here, Miyoko is Hideki Anno's wife.
Yeah, and obviously they married in, I think slightly before 1.11 was released. But anyway, you know, this is it, you know. But Miyoko Anno makes a film, obviously, for this, and it's like, yeah, this was a big... And it's sort of, in the strangest visual imagery, it's sort of visually referred to as this massive dike on this massive turnip that is obviously like pulled out of the ground, and it's like, I mean, obviously the in-universe for that, the in-cartoon version of Hideaki Anno sort of ends up injuring himself, sort of pulling this massive thing out of the ground, and yeah. So I you know, as I said, I don't think we'll ever get an insight to Hideaki Anno's mental state was. You know, as I said, with a lot of things, we are basically coming from things that Hideaki Anno himself has said, and Anno tends to be, with his own mental health, a fairly at least a more guarded individual than he was during the production of the original series. Obviously, you don't quite know why he's done that, but obviously, you know, so a lot of it does come from secondhand and conjecture. But as I said, it's clear that Anno is dealing with depression throughout the production of this film, and boy, does that color the film.
Yeah, just the entire thing after the first 25 minutes.
Yeah, as I said, I'm trying to think of another film to parallel with it in terms of how, you know, this is what somebody who is obviously struggling with their mental health makes. I mean, you got obviously loads of music and sort of stuff, but is, you know, in terms of a cinematic parallel, more difficult, you know, is
there's Lars von Trier, who is constantly depressed, but he doesn't make depressed films like this. He makes tormenting the innocent woman movies. That's probably based on my opinion, but
I would agree with you. I'm not, as a cinematic critic, I stick well clear of von Trier, because there is like, you know, obviously depressed creatives tend to go in one direction. Anno turns inwards, von Trier turns outwards, and really quite nastily in a lot of cases. Anno self lacerates, von Trier just lacerates.
Yeah.
And it's sort of the interesting, the obviously, so this starts to kind of, so basically Shinji and to an extent Anno is basically in for the majority of this film, and I feel we can sort of draw an analogy, they're in depressive fugues, they are literally just, mm-hmm. there is nothing at home, nobody, you know, they have basically, obviously we see it in Thrice, but Thrice takes it in a very different direction. Obviously Thrice has a fairly justifiable reason for it, but it's like, you know,
yeah.
And essentially the, you know, Shinji is then basically kidnapped by somebody purporting to be Rei. It's again, it's a little bit, we hear the voice of Rei, you know, and obviously we're never quite, is it, obviously again it's something that 3.33 that Thrice answers again to a certain extent. But it's like, again, it's like, you know, and Shinji basically gets kidnapped and taken to Nerve, and, hi Gendo. Hello.
And then Gendo's like, hello, son. I have another assignment for you. Do it. Bye.
Bye. And then he disappears for the rest of the film.
Yep.
Yeah, I think this is the least Gendo we get in, like, any of the Evangelion films. It's just like, he's there... Fuzu, yeah, is there.
Fiutsuki
is, well, you're the one correcting me all this stuff. Fiutsuki, yes. Is there, I mean, yes. Yeah, and as I said, you know, the 3.33 is more a film of emotion rather than things that happen, and a lot of that emotion is not good. And we're introduced to Kaworu.
Yes.
I really like this. I mean, I'm a Kaworu fanboy. I'm just going to admit that here.
Yeah.
I feel he's... This is like... Again, so, you know, obviously, to an extent, the... All four of the Evangelion films do sort of, refer and refract and, you know, basically distill down the original series. This is basically episode 24 as a feature film. Like, with bits mm-hmm. and bits sort of bolted onto the front and back. They're fucking cute, Joe.
Okay. I have a specific feeling on Kaworu and Shinji. And this comes from my personal emotions. Mm. Like, I have a really easy distrust of people who are too nice to me. Mm. All of my depression when it comes from other people is, I don't want to say trigger, but it mm-hmm. is poked at by this film. Yeah. Like, yeah. It has a way of poking at some raw nerves that even if I've worked for decades on, that it's still nerve damage. Yeah. Nerves regenerate at a far lesser speed mm-hmm. than anything else. So if you touch raw nerves, it's still, I mean,
completely.
just in this analogy. But what really hits with me on this film is the idea that you tried to do good and you completely fucked it up and everybody hates you now.
Yeah.
That is like my... Yeah. biggest anxiety in the world, that all of what I did was for nothing. And the other end of that is that everybody is nice to you because they want something from you, and the moment they can't get that from you is when they are going to turn against you. And that is something in the Kaworu Shinji relationship that I don't want to say I don't like, but I it puts me at a distance from it.
And that I totally understand. I mean, as there is the thing is with Kaworu and Shinji's relationship is perhaps more than any other Evangelion's relationship, it is really something, and it's going to sound particularly, it's something I feel that the fan base have really sort of like almost done like the panopticon, the in the round with, you know, I've seen character interpretations all the way from Kaworu is madly, deeply in love with Shinji and would literally end the world to make him happy, to Kaworu is a manipulative douchebag who basically got Shinji in the one place where he had like a chink in the hedgehog's armor, and basically gaslit him into killing into basically assisted suicide. You know, Kaworu is a, considering, as I said, considering Kaworu is in the original series for one episode, mm-hmm. He continues to like. You know, really, as I said, I he is probably of Evangelion's characters the, considering based off Alnium, he appears for like 13 minutes of one episode. You know, we're talking like a character who has less than 20 minutes screen time and something like two dozen lines. And around this, the fandom has built everything from. He's the sweetest boy to them, basically. Hi, it's Akira from Devilman. It's Ryoko Akira from Devilman again, you stupid motherfuckers. It's it's literally Lucifer, you know. And,
yes,
you know,
yes,
yeah. It's like there, Kaworu is I feel like Kaworu is a character where I feel like people take personal interpretations and, you know, attach, and obviously, you know, we've got two perfect examples here. You know, I will admit, hand on heart, I am a terrible rotten Fujoshi, and, you know, I find the thing quite sweet and quite tragic, and there's sort of like, you know, maybe we'll be happy in the next thing, but also you can obviously see, you obviously interpret it in a very different way, and yeah, he's being too nice. There is a motive behind him being so, and mm-hmm. both are valid. You know, that's the thing.
There are two things out of this. Like, we have seen Kaworu go through, be in this the entire way. Mm. Like, he's at the end of 1.11. Yeah. They see him on the moon in 2.22.
Yeah,
and now he's here, and there's this feeling that he is, that this has been going on for a while, that this reset and redoing is been happening for a while, and he is the only one truly 100% aware of what's going on.
Yeah,
and there is this feeling that there is some sort of character arc, despite that at the beginning it does feel like he's kind of manipulating. I mean, there's and at the end he has this real emotion for Shinji near the end, and we'll talk to that when we get to that, like,
completely,
because there is this point where he stops addressing Shinji in near the end of the movie, and he starts getting in his own mind, because it's essentially he thought this was going to be over, and like, oh, no, this wasn't how it was supposed to be. And he stops addressing Shinji entirely, but then he goes back to it because, he realizes there's this person and he actually cares about this person. So there is this character arc, but there is, you know, always that feeling that he started as a manipulator that, you know, will keep me a little distant from it. So, you know.
There is a duplicity to Kaworu, regardless of how you interpret him. You know, there is always going to be, you know, the, you know, he is somewhere between the human and the angel, and, you know, you know, he is, as I said, he's a character that I feel like hits in a really interesting way. And as I said, the only kind of character I can really compare him to is, you know, Satan in Devilman, because, you know, that's the complexity of the character. There is, you know, a sadness to Kaworu. You know, Kaworu is a character. There is, you know, again, for a character who appears for under 20 minutes in one episode, that's about the same time as good old Jet Alone. he leaves incredible marks on the series. And, you know, but I do like the sort of sensibility of Anno in this film, where there is like this, for all, you know, Karu's kindness and his sweetness, there is this sort of slightly eldritch other sort of thing going on with him. You know, we get the feeling more than I feel the original series of, yeah, this guy is not quite human and doesn't really exist on the same sort of like wavelength as much human as most humans. And you know, we've seen this guy chilling out in space in jeans with no shirt. You know, there's a sense of like, maybe this guy is not entirely human
and thus doesn't process things in a human manner.
Yeah completely. Yeah, so basically, slowly, Karu and Shinji sort of like, I don't want to say like form a relationship. It's very, very, you know, distant at first, and Shinji is very, you know, hesitant. And, you know, Shinji's basically been, you know, in like stasis for 14 years and doesn't really know what's going on. And he's obviously quite rightfully paranoid after like the whole never pilot an Ava again. Also, Asuka has an eye patch and tried to punch you in the face.
Yeah, we need to go back a little bit, because we didn't talk about Misato has started this new organization, and they are fighting Phil. And they are fighting Nerv.
Nerv.
And
just Nerv.
And also, Zayal is said differently, or Zayle, or whatever Zayle else. There are four different pronunciations of
please
that.
Please
stop that. anyway, so they are fighting Nerv now because, like, Gendo is giving up his humanity and he's trying to finish the human instrumentation project, which involves killing all mankind, and he is trying to, you know, finish that and, you know, get his final plans in.
And Misato and Koa getting in the way of said plans because, hey, we're not going down without a fight.
No. And so the organization is Misato, why did I forget her doctor friend?
Ritsuko.
Yes, Ritsuko. Yeah. I don't know why I forget her name all the time.
The bridge. Basically, it's everyone in Nerv apart from Gendo and Vietsu. And Mari, who's sort of just joined up for some reason, I'm sure.
we'll get to the Mary talk in the next episode. But and there's also Sakura, who is Toji's little sister.
Yeah.
Who was, there was much to do about the fight injuring Sakura in the first episode, and then Toji punches Shinji because Toji loves his sister very much. And so now here she is, like an adult, I believe. She looks kind of like 16, 15-ish, but...
Yeah.
But it's implied 13 years have passed, so she is near an adult and is working as the medical officer on the Ville. Or the Wunder. The Wunder.
The Wunder.
They are on the ship that is a combination of battleships, because Hideaki Anno, and this giant Nerv airship that they stole. And they made it fly, and it is... fueled by Ava 1.
Yep.
And they create their own AT field, and they can make it, the AT field, do whatever they want. They can make it like the shields in Star Trek and focus it on one area, or, you know, this is basically, they have integrated Ava and Angel technology into everyday use.
Yeah. And it's kind of a cool tech jump. It does feel like this is going to be the next sort of, this is going to be like the next thing. You know, if you go 10 minutes into the future with Evangelion's tech, they're going to bolt shit to an angel and see what happens.
It reminds me at the end of Simone, which is just this, I guess it's kind of a mech series. It's kind of not, but it is a Yuri series where pairs of women have to defend their country as holy priestesses. And eventually, as they learn about all the other countries, and eventually the other countries catch up to them, and they eventually get defeated, and they have to... And they slowly see the change of technology as people learn what they use, and they learn how it works, and then they use it against them. Yeah. And that is kind of what is happening here. We don't really get to explore it because that's not what this movie is about.
Yeah.
But we get to see it, and I do like cool time skip things like this. I just don't like it here because mainly it is everybody like is throwing a stink eye at Shinji, and it's like, don't do anything. Stop it. Stop it. Oh God, you're making it worse. Why are you doing this? We told you to stop.
Go sit and time out, Shinji.
Yeah, go sit and time out, and we're going to put an explosive collar around you so we can stop you. And this is how much we don't trust you. And also, we are surrounded, like, the new crew members, like, one of them had their entire family killed when Shinji set off the near impact, as they called it.
Yeah, that is... Oh, God, what's her bloody name? That is Midori Kitakami, who is also, like, in a... They did, like, a couple of short OVA things, which, you know, basically she stars in and has Asuka in it, looking really cool. You know, and that is sort of like, you know, her introduction. Yeah, she will become a little bit more important in the next film. She's
another. Why I forget her name is Midori is because her hair is pink and not green.
Yep.
And Midori is the word for green.
Yeah, her hair isn't green originally either, which is particularly odd.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that's just like the rest of the bridge team are fine. They're just like, there's a couple of like, you know, tough guys. There's Akio Osutak,
and then there's Maya, who is you know,
Maya's
there.
Fine. Yeah, and there's like, you know, you get a couple of other cool characters. There's a Solid Snake's voice actor is just in this playing like one of the bridge crew. I think he's the big burly. I think he's the big burly bloke with the bald head. He's sort of like, you know, obviously the old guy who's seen it all and is just like, yeah, well, if we die, we die.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Kachi isn't here, as will be revealed later in Thrice.
But all of this would be cool if the movie's focus wasn't on how much everybody doesn't like Shinji or is manipulating Shinji for their own purposes. And we are seeing all of these people from this world. And in the last movie, I mean, we were seeing them in hopeful circumstances where we were going to like a zoo of oceanic research where, you know, they're cleaning the water. Everything's going to be fine. Everybody's having a good time. They even allowed the penguin along to see everything. And now all of these people are now sullen and they're just
broken,
tragic, and they're irrevocably broken, sometimes physically, like with Asuka and her missing eye. And we get this weird thing where, like, I don't know how well they explain it. They kind of do, and after I've watched these things a couple times, I pick it up, like, Asuka and the way the Ava pilots work, if they go long enough, is they essentially become gods. They stop aging. They get part angel, from what I understand. And they are no longer what they would consider human.
Yeah.
And,
I mean, Asuka much later in the film literally just goes, yeah, we'll wait for the Lilin to turn up. And Lilin is like the word that otherwise only Karu uses to refer to humans. It's like,
humans, yeah.
Okay, Asuka, you know, I mean, obviously there are reasons why Asuka in particular uses that, but we'll have to wait for Thrice for that, because it's like, this is the problem. This is sort of like the problem with 3.33, is because it is so much of a depressive fugue of a film, it's like Thrice has to do so much explaining of like what was going on in this time period that it's sort of like it makes 3.33 even like weaker than it should be, because it's like, I appreciate obviously it's all from Shinji's perspective and Shinji's not going to have all the answers to the questions, but it's like, you know, really basic questions like, where's Kachi and what happened and what happened to everybody else that sort of thrice then spends its first hour sort of like going, okay, you want answers, it's fine.
But also it is necessary on an emotional level. We'll get into that when we talked on Thrice. But yeah, this, if it was this time jump, because I like these kind of time jumps. I like seeing, you know, all of this used creatively. But the problem is it is at the service of this film, which is poking at the worst parts of my insecurities.
Yeah.
And so... Yeah. We're seeing these new these familiar characters, like, all grown up, and Ritsuko's cut her hair, and Misato's in command now, but it's all wrong, and it's everybody... And since Shinji's the central focal point, everybody feels like they're staring at you, and you disappointed them. Yeah. And maybe that's me, because I've had issues where my emotions were withdrawn for a few years, and then... they came back, and now sometimes they can't stop, especially when I'm watching a movie and I'm letting myself be less guarded. And so it really does feel like they are staring into me. I'm the one who fucked up. I'm the one who failed, and they are disappointed in me. And that's
that is part of me.
I am not in a good place after this film, and like, I had a chat with my wife afterwards, and she could tell I was, like, visibly shaken, which is why I am never watching this film again. And
I had to immediately watch Thrice after this, because I needed to be cheered up. Like, let's be very, very simple. I would say similar, but also approaching Shinji from a different angle and going, hey, not pleasant to be in a position where nobody likes you and you having to second guess what everybody's thinking about you. Worse for Shinji, starting the apocalypse for rescuing Rei. Rei is nowhere to be seen.
Instead, we have this clone of Rei who is being told nothing but orders from Gendo. Yeah. And it's the start of a relationship that we'll get far more into in Thrice, but right now there is nothing there. And essentially her response is to anything, am I ordered to? And there is... some slight sparks there where she goes, I'm not Rei Ayanami?
Yeah.
Then who am I?
Yeah, and it only starts to come at, like, the last 10 minutes of the film, by which time it's like things have got very bad indeed.
Yeah, the new Rei is essentially not much of an element in this movie except for furthering the emptiness of Shinji and feeling like he did nothing but cause pain to everyone else.
Obviously interwoven with this is scenes of Shinji and Karu spending time together and learning the piano. The piano stuff on this is really, really nicely animated. I think this is like one of few places that Ava... I think they actually used rotoscoping for some of it, which is basically a technique in animation where you, if I briefly explain, where you draw over footage. Disney used it a lot.
They absolutely used rotoscope. If you watch enough anime or animation, you can tell the difference in movement. It is extremely fluid. And I don't want to diss people who are like really fluid. I mean, I don't want to diss rotoscoping. You can just kind of tell because there is an increase in frame rate or something like that. There's an increase in like how it moves.
Completely. And that is because if you're taking from reference film is going to be on 24 frames per second. Therefore, you are basically compared to normal animation. I think most of Evangelion, as I think we've mentioned before, is animated on two. So basically, that means 12 frames per second. You know, most anime, unless you're talking about Ghibli stuff, and by Ghibli stuff, we're talking, you know, really stuff like that. The running sequence from Princess Kaguya, you know, is probably going to be animated on twos because it basically, unless you're somebody like 1980s Akira, unless you're someone like Akira, or you're, you know, Ghost in the Shell, which is almost entirely animated at once.
Or you're in the bubble economy and people just have money to burn on everything.
You're doing on twos. And obviously you can tell when the frame rate goes up. And Evangelion uses frame rate quite cool, to quite cool effects, obviously, particularly in Thrice, as we'll come on to talk about. Yeah, but you can tell it's obviously, you know, they are drawing from film because the frame rate goes up, and obviously they are going, you know, they are animating on ones. It's a beautifully done sequence, and it's sort of like really well done. It's a really, really, I mean, it's a good
cinematic shorthand of how they formed their relationship, because he's Kaworu, like, here, take a seat and start playing, but I don't know how to play the piano, and but here he starts playing, and then Kaworu does this amazing, like, duet, like, filling in the holes, and you know, and then it gets better and better, and, like, the animation especially gets amazing, because they're not doing it as they're keying, they're doing it under the piano as the chords are getting hit, which is just this extremely mind-blowing thing as me, who is a not visual person, and I would have to like, okay, let's look at the, it would take me years to do that, and I'm sure it did take somebody years to do that. I mean, as I've learned from, like, CG and a lot of things, there are a lot of things that, little things that are one person. Like, I just watched a podcast of two people who had a friend who worked on Benjamin Button, and there was one person who just worked on Benjamin Button's tongue CG as he aged.
Oh, completely. Yeah. I mean, there's one particular shot in Thrice, which we'll get onto, which took one guy at Studio Kara like a year and a half to do, and that was like his one shot for the film. And it's ridiculous. It's like, it is just like, you know, there is, you know, with animation, it's like, and obviously with the original End of Evangelion, like, the Asuka mass production fight is mostly animated by one guy. It's insane in places.
Yeah,
like,
it's...
But you can tell a lot.
Yeah, you can tell. And there's... Is this thing, like, when they move to digital away from hand-drawn, there's that feeling that, you know, textile feeling that this was all done by one person, like the when somebody runs a corner and then they do a perspective shot or they switch, there is that tactile feeling like in Gunbuster or something like that, that this was done by hand by one person that isn't here, but that doesn't mean there isn't, like, one person still working furious on this to make this look perfect.
Yeah. And obviously, you know, obviously the whole way that the rebound films are animated, sort of like, gives, you know, when you go back to obviously hand drawn, which is obviously the hand drawn animation is done mostly for the characters. So, like, you know, obviously the Evangelions these days are done in CGI, but obviously, you know, with a lot of, you know, stylistic stuff to make it look hand drawn. Everything involving the characters is hand drawn from, like, floor up. I think there are certain elements on Asuka in Thrice, I think, that our computer age will get into that shortly. But obviously, you know, the piano sequence is really fucking good.
Yeah, and it is animated really well, and it's a good cinematic shorthand for getting this relationship in a short amount of time.
Yeah, and I think it might be Sakasu playing the piano on it. If it's not Sakasu, it's somebody else, but obviously it's somebody inside the Ava team, and it's like, and Sakasu obviously uses a lot, because it's obviously a film mostly about Karen Shinji's thing, he obviously uses a lot of piano-based stuff in it, you know, and a lot of piano-based stuff,
I should also note, through the turmoil, through the movie changing or whatever else, this is also the shortest of the rebuild movies. It is about
96 minutes long.
96, 97 minutes long, thereabouts. obviously, it didn't want to linger on itself for too long, because the first 25 minutes are explaining getting to the start of the plot, and not, it's the, you know, action sequence with the thing falling in orbit, and then we have the you know, angel attack or whatever nerve sent to attack, and then the story, you know, starts modestly, if depressingly.
And it's sort of here that we get our whammer moment, so to speak. Good job breaking it, Shinji. Well done.
Yeah, like, there is this huge feeling that gets more and more depressing as it goes along, that the more people, like, Shinji confides in, the worse it gets in this film, because there is the scene in with Fuyutsuki that often gets lost in the shuffle, where, here, play Shoji with me, and you think he's gonna do some sort of personal thing. But what he's doing is explaining why him rescuing Rei was futile. Because they're in this dark room, and the power's back on. And it slowly reveals... It's an amazingly well-done sequence. But this is, like, king manipulative shit.
Yeah.
Because Fuyutsuki is just a tool bag at this point.
Yeah.
Where it turns on and there's more Rei clones and there's more terrible things in the background going on, explaining the master plan of all of this and how what Shinji did was nothing, because that one Rei was just a whole bunch of Reis, and, like, you know, what you did was causing the apocalypse for this clone that was an empty vessel, and you blah blah blah, and, like,
it's beautifully executed, but you do want to punch, like, Fuyutsuki, who's
even at the end of it, it's like, oh god, why did I do that?
Yeah,
I mean, in his Fuyutsuki way of I'm still Gendo's fuckboy.
I mean, he's like, Fuyutsuki's like 80s. I mean, you don't want to punch him in the face. Like, come on, my dude, do not. You know, it's like, this is like the thing. It's like, even Fuyutsuki, who's like always felt in Evangelion like a character who, like, Shinji can confide in, is like, yep, nope. You can't stop Gendo. He's going to attack and dethrone God.
Yep.
Which he proceeds to basically, like, and, you know, I think, is it this that Gendo, like, switches off Sile as well? It's like, oh, well, we can see that everything's well, and cool, just unplug us.
Yep, and then he switches them off, and then you see this, like, outline of a brain before they shut off, so it's just like, he's, even though they've transferred their minds to, you know, a computer conscious or whatever it is, that he just fucking killed them. And it's like, nothing in this movie can't be not depressing or horrifying when you think about it.
Gendo, and this is like the start of, you know, Gendo up until this point has been, like, in 1 and 2 has basically been his good old self of being distant, vaguely abusive father. This is when Gendo sort of completely starts to basically go, I'm the villain of the entire thing. It's like, this is not telegraphed at all. It's like, yep, I'm the villain. I've just turned
this
off.
This is
like,
where essentially he's been rejecting his humanity.
Yeah, that, like, gets worse in the next film.
He's not even wearing his glasses anymore. Like, I don't know. If you want to do an arc with the glasses, there's the glasses that melted when he saved Rei, and you can say he did that as a manipulative act to make her bound to him. And so he wears these, you know, tougher villain glasses. And now he has this visor that makes him look almost alien to a certain extent. And he'll look more alien in the next film. So there is that visual distinction of him, like, losing his humanity. And
there's a really creepy little thing, actually, if you note with Gendo. Like, with Masato, and certainly obviously with Fuyutsuki, you can see they have aged. You know, obviously, Fuyutsuki is, like, as I said, at this point, is in his late, is like his mid-80s. Like, you know, he's, you know, basically being held together by his will. And Masato obviously looks different. Gendo hasn't changed in 14 years.
Nope.
Nope, and that's sort of like the first inkling you get, which of the obviously thrice that Gendo might not be entirely human himself anymore.
Mm-hmm.
This is the thing, like, a lot of this goes in concert with thrice, and like a lot of it goes, you know, this, you know, as I said, I feel like one and two sort of are in concert with each other, and three and four are sort of in concert with each other, and you know what you make of that. And obviously I think that that break was always going to come because of Anno's depression, but you know, as I said, there is, you know, they almost like act as a pair of, you know, duologies together. Anyway, yeah, good break. Yeah, Shinji, you've done an apocalypse, mate.
Yep. And he wants to make good with it. There is this plan to use Ava Unit 13, which is the first one that doesn't require an AT field.
Yep.
And dual plug.
Two pilots.
So he doesn't have to be afraid, and he has Kaworu with him this whole time. Mm-hmm. And they're getting the two, they're essentially going down to Geofront to get the two spears that are going to make this all right and make the world fine. So, I can see on paper how this would be sound like a good idea, except that Gendo's running the whole thing, and we know what's been happening when Gendo's running the whole thing, but Shinji is not in the mental state where he can construct this.
No.
This is his
rational decisions, to be frank.
Yeah, no, absolutely. He, like, will find that out in the climax. He is absolutely not there anymore. But this is his last find to hold on to, where it's not, he can fix things and he'll make it right, even, and he'll fix mistakes, because there's obvious this with Kaworu especially. He talks to him about making atonement. And it is not a well-sold idea by the people on the Vunder, who is just like, we are going to put an explosive collar on you, and you are going to be in this room, and you don't do anything ever again.
Yeah, which
that
is
your
really
atonement.
There is one really interesting comment I'm going to make about that. It's like, they put him on him, and obviously he is getting kidnapped by Ray, question mark. And Misato doesn't pull the trigger.
Yeah.
And continues not to pull the trigger until he gets out of sight. And there is this, like, I feel in, like, another, if Anno had been, you know, obviously taken this plot point and then gone in a different direction with it, you know, I feel like that would have really come back in, like, some form. Because it feels like, you know, she still has some, like, degree of, I mean, Asuka is a whole different kettle of fish, which we'll get into again next episode. Gotta stop saying that. which, you know, obviously, but you know, but there is a sense where Misato is, yeah, he's my son and he's fucked up, but he's still technically my surrogate sort of like child, and I don't feel comfortable blowing my surrogate child's head off.
Yes, it is essentially saying she's trying to be Gendo, but she cannot be Gendo because she is too human. It is still there. Mm-hmm. And next episode we'll talk about more of the parallels, but she is doing this out of a place of love, and it is a part of the place of love Gendo was still in when his wife died, and a part of the reason why he separated from Shinji, and there's that parallel.
Mm-hmm.
And there are more on-the-nose parallels to that.
No,
but, yes, absolutely, completely. But, so, that, all of that is going on. It is Misato trying to be Gendo, and failing, essentially.
Asuka trying to be Misato to an extent as well.
And failing, too, because, one, she doesn't have good coping mechanisms for that. Her coping mechanism is fighting and protecting. And I mean, Masato to a certain extent, but Masato also has booze at the end of the day that, like, dulls the edge of everything she's been through. And obviously we have, you know, the rebuilds, you can watch them on their own, but you are not going to get all of the context on your own. Mm-hmm. Like, Asuka's finger puppet and what that means.
Yeah,
exactly. And the full... And
the films have always, as we said, obviously when we talked about obviously 1.1 and 2.22 are enriched by understanding the original series, and obviously, you know, the finale of this is no different as we get some gratuitous Beethoven. Guess what, Shinji? Guess what, Karu? That thing that you thought was the thing at the bottom of Terminal Dogma that you thought would solve everything? No. 2 for 2, Karu, well done.
Yep.
It's like, this seems familiar.
It's two separate spears that are not going to do what you want. They are going to do the opposite of what you want.
Yep, it's been... 0 days since another impact. Well done, guy.
Yes.
They start fourth impact. I mean...
Yeah.
Yeah, they start fourth impact. Which basically is exactly what... exactly what Gendo wanted to happen.
Yep.
Fuck that guy in particular. this is like the thing... This is like the film where you go... Yeah, Gendo's up to something, and like obviously throughout the film we go, what is Gendo? Ah, that's what Gendo's up to. He's trying to start Thilf Impact. And obviously activate Unit 13, which, you know, obviously will make a reappearance in the next film. Misato is not going to take the second impact happening on her. The second impact to have on her watch standing lying down, and she sends Asuka and Mari to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
The fight scene in this is really good again. It's like it's a finale I like and I don't like. It feels like Anno's trying to desperately sort of G himself up into an action sequence again. It's like, but it feels like it feels wrong in a way. It feels like, you know, every time that Anno sort of goes, we're going to do a cool action sequence, I get to make robots fight each other. And it's like,
but it is all wrong. It is Asuka fighting Shinji, and it is Kaworu, once he realizes what's going on, being completely despondent from everything, leaving Shinji alone to be beaten up by this person who, you know, had a crush on him at one point, at least. Yeah. I mean, even in 2.22, she was getting her fingers cut trying to make the dinner with Gendo and Shinji. So there was all of that on there. And Mari, we have to talk about next episode. I played this game with Tama, so don't worry about it. It's because Tama, until now, had not seen Thrice.
Yeah.
And there were some very important information that was left out that I couldn't tell him, and we can't talk about until we get to Thrice, and then we get to spoilery talks about Thrice.
Mari does feel like, compared to like 2.22, where she is like screaming in people's faces and going completely berserk, does feel really benched for the majority of this film. And I don't know if that's a deliberate decision, or whether Mari hijinks would have like pushed this film in a direction that Anno didn't feel comfortable making. You know, obviously, it's very easy to throw Mari into this and go, no, Shinji, you're not being depressed. Come on this way, puppy, this way.
but also, there is that feeling that she's disappointed in Shinji, but there is not that malice that the other characters have.
She's disappointed him in the way one would be disappointed of a friend you still support. It's like, you know, you made Asuka unhappy. You didn't turn up for her. It's your, you know, I'm disappointed in you, but we can make this right. And, Yeah, we'll get to that particular aspect of her character next episode. Yeah, and there's also, by the way, during this, like, Kara is just getting, like, bobbed down angel status-wise from, like, first. So, yeah, obviously, Kara is quite obviously adamant at this point to just plain old 13th. Yeah.
And then there is this, like, I will say there is this creepy point where they keep getting deeper and deeper, and then there's these... thousands of lost souls that look like a Legion from Castlevania Symphony of the Night. Just these Evas, or these souls that got, that were trying to reach the barrier of, like, existence, and then, you know, essentially got fried out of the existence. And exactly how or why, I don't know if we know or want to know. I mean, they do explain it, but I don't think we want to know the full extent.
No, there's, like, a lot of stuff in this that's, like, the weird sort of version of near Second Impact.
Yeah, and I think it's a lot of based on a lot of Renaissance art, because I remember to museums and, like, just seeing, like, a lot of art like this, where it's just, like, people folded together in this white...
sort of
thing that resembles
Bosch-ish.
The brain.
Hieronymus Bosch sort of shit going on. There are also really other really, really fucking creepy things, and I genuinely fucking unnerves me, is the giant ray head just hanging out in Terminal Dogma. It's like, so, yeah, it's basically, so, at some point, it's sort of implied again, this is to go back to the event between 2.22 and 3.33, is Karu had to basically put down Lilith, who had basically become, like, at some point, Lilith sort of woke up and started wandering towards thing, and so obviously that was, like, you know, part of near Third Impact, and Unit sort of 6 is just fused with it, and it's like, except for the head, which is just this giant sort of, like, really creepy End of Evangelion style ray head that's just hanging out in Terminal Dogma, you know, without any eyes. Really fucking creepy. Not pleasant to look at. There's more creepy ray stuff on the way, but that'll be later. So Kaworu basically has an existential crisis, which, not great for Shinji. Shinji basically starts, and he basically goes, yeah, this is what we've come for, and unfortunately, by this point, Shinji is very much sort of, like, shut off from, like, any external thing, because he's got it into his head. If he does this, everything will be okay, and... yeah,
he essentially bet everything he owned on this, and it's turning out wrong, but he still has to convince itself he can make this right. And it is not going well, and he has just basically gone on automatic pilot, and he is just like a zombie, like, just fed by this, you know, lizard brain thing that if I do this thing, it will be right. So... even when he's talking, he is not really talking. He is just going to autopilot.
Yeah, completely. And, Kaworu has already taken the collar off Shinji as a, to gain his trust. And it's really at that point that I feel like that's something that Kaworu has done out of genuine love for Shinji. It's like, you are solely to blame for this, you know, I have taken on the burden, you know, to again sort of flop into that Judeo-Christian sort of, like, weight of sin sort of thing. It's like, no, I've taken at least a little bit of the weight of your actions on myself, and, you know, if it goes wrong, it's quite literally on my head that it falls.
Yeah, and since Kaworu isn't human, he doesn't understand that that's not how it works. So there is, like, there is a flaw in his thinking.
A rather fatal flaw, unfortunately. Fourth Impact is going just, like, swimmingly, and Asuka is like trying her best to basically get rid of, you know, to fight. I think, and then she ends up in a, like, Mari, is it Mari who ends up in a fight with, like, the Ray clone? And the Ray clone basically has her own, I think, no, it's Asuka fighting her, and the Ray clone has basically her own existential breakdown and goes, okay, well, yeah, you might, you know, that, we'll just,
oh,
you know,
yeah.
What does Ray iron up? You know, but what do you want to do? And it's like, in that yeah. shot ejects from Unit Zero. It's like, yep.
Yeah. That's Mari. I think Mari just kind of acts outside of, you know, all of these people's personal shit and like kind of gets an opinion or, you know, finds something. And we'll talk about that later, obviously.
It's almost like that's representing something.
Yep. And then like Asuka is fighting Shinji and eventually gets to Shinji. And Karu's, like, head detonates in front of Shinji, which is completely horrifying. And Asuka ejects Shinji. And then she has to eject with Shinji.
It's brutal. It's, like, there is an unpleasant viscerality to, like, that scene. It's just, like, oh. Mm-hmm. Because it's, like, it feels like, you know, the original way that it does it, it's melancholic. This is like outright horrifying. It's just like, oh, the sort of the moment he puts the collar on, it's like the Chekhov's gun. It's like he has the collar on, that's gonna detonate at some point, isn't it? It's and it's still like, you know, and Karu's still trying to put a brave face. It's like, don't worry, should you, you know. And it's like, obviously, he's aware of the loop and the fact that, like, hey, I'm sorry, this wasn't what you wanted, but
next time. Yeah, and you need to find your own place to live, and the people you know will lead the way, which, you know, leads us to the next film. And they do stop this particular impact.
Black Moon is just popped out, and Gendo. It has gone even more to shit.
It has pushed more to, the whole world is ending, but it's not there yet.
No.
And then, you know, at the end of this, we get this scene of Ray ? Shinji ? And Asuka pissed off. In this desolate land that essentially Shinji has created, quote unquote. I mean, it under the manipulation of his father, of course, but and they are walking away, and that's the to be continued. It is it does not have the same, you know, exciting pop at the end of 2.22, where it is this new world is created. We are completely off script. We are going to make this brand new thing. And
And even Utada Hikaru's song on this, which is Sakura Nagashi, is just like real. You know, for Utada, he's downbeat. It's like,
there is no beautiful boy in this.
There is no beautiful boy in this. And, you know, a lot of that, obviously, you know, I feel we do need to talk about, like, there is, obviously, given this film comes out barely a year after, like, the Tohoku earthquake, there is a lot of, like, you know, yes, absolutely, Anno is doing a lot of stuff from internal sort of sensibility, and, you know, a lot of it does come from Anno's depression. I do feel like you have to sort of view parts of this film, and obviously what Anno will do next between the Evangelion films certainly riffs off that, and certainly is a is a direct and extremely angry response to the obviously the Fukushima meltdown.
The chloridization, which is making everything red and unlivable. That is an analogy for something else that we are going to get to the next film.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah, so we have to finish up our thoughts on this and go.
I respect this film. I understand why it was made. I respect this film. I don't like this film. I don't think I'm ever gonna like this film. And I feel that, frankly, that is probably, if you asked Hideaki Anno his response, it's probably going to be, it was a necessary film to make. It was not an enjoyable film to make.
Yes. And I pretty much have the exact same thoughts of you. I mean, I even shared the Letterboxd, my Letterboxd review of it, which was exactly what you put, almost exactly what you put in the comments. Yeah. It's just like, exactly. I understand why the film was like this. I understand why it was made. I don't have to like it.
I would question. I would question politely, you know, the mentality of someone who would regard this as their favorite.
Well, I can.
It's a necessary linking piece. It feels there is an unpleasant misanthropic streak to this film.
Yes. What I would say is I do kind of understand, because I was in a certain place where I was probably a safer place where I had a amount of empathy, and like it was best served by going through films and learning that, oh, other people have felt this and other people have expressed this feeling. Mm-hmm. But, you know, a lot of stuff happened in my life that has like kind of... I wouldn't say ground my empathy down, but it's still there, but has changed how it responds. Mm-hmm. And this film is not healthy for me. I do not respond well to it.
I don't either, frankly.
So much of it reflects some stuff that has happened to me in my life, and there is one big thing I am never going to talk about, because... It involves people other than me, and involves other people making mistakes, and me just losing my goddamn head for about 4 or 5 months. And, I can take what I've done fine. The other people will not be able to take, you know, this being broadcast and this being out there.
Fine.
So,
I respect it, absolutely. Understand where it comes from, absolutely. I don't think we're ever going to talk about this film again, either of us.
This film harms me. So, like, whatever good points it does, whatever necessity it is, I need to stay away from it. This is the last time I'm going to watch it. It is going to sit there on my shelf with the rest of my collection, and just stay there. It's going to collect dust. I might watch 2.2. I'm definitely going to watch Thrice again. I am never watching this again. And probably 1.11, just because it's so much like the parts I don't like in a Godzilla film. And the parts I do like are kind of emotionally played out. Like, I've watched it enough that I got this. I'm not feeling this part of it anymore. So it's just watching a... really well done thing that I, you know, don't have an attachment to, but just let's put this away. Let's go to Thrice. Let's go
Thrice
to Thrice.
Thrice time. See you tomorrow.
Yes. See you tomorrow. And, oh God. Get me a drink. I need a drink.